I appreciate so many of you expressing interest in this topic and our speaker. I also want to thank C-SPAN for recording this talk for broader public consumption. If you haven't been to the temporary exhibit that prompted this program, I hope you will take advantage of your time here to visit the Korten Gallery and enjoy Along the Iron Curtain, Germany's Cold War Frontier. There are also palm cards at the museum store that lists some of our upcoming events scheduled over the next few months. We're excited to showcase copies of the Emancipation Proclamation and 13th Amendment signed by Abraham Lincoln throughout our upcoming Civil War exhibit. And for a 10-day period that will include Hoover's hometown days from July 30 to August 11, we will host George Washington's personal copy of the first printing of the Acts of Congress. This book, on loan from George Washington's Mount Vernon, contains President Washington's penciled annotation in the margins dealing with executive powers. Finally, these public programs are provided free of charge only because of this private support for this institution. The Herbert Hoover Presidential Library Association not only supports many of the programs here at the Library Museum, but also at the Herbert Hoover National Historic Site, located just outside these doors. These brochures are found in the lobby that detail more about the good work provided by the Library Association, and I encourage you to take one home with you. If you've been following news lately, several stories have appeared in the last few weeks describing a battle in Berlin to save a 25-meter stretch of the Berlin Wall from being removed or relocated. A developer received approval to move the wall, allowing for construction of a park that surrounds a luxury tower construction. Previously, sections of the wall had been demolished or moved without incident, as many Germans wanted to forget this ugly chapter in their history. But now, more Germans think it is important to have visible reminders of the past, when Germany was a divided country and Berlin a divided city. Herbert Hoover had a long involvement with Germany. His food relief efforts in the aftermath of World War I were instrumental in feeding a defeated and hungry nation. In 1938, at the urging of Hugh Wilson, United States Ambassador to Germany, Hoover met briefly with Adolf Hitler and found Der Führer not to be the bumbling dummy that American media often characterized him. Rather, Hoover correctly discerned Hitler's intelligence and saw him as a malicious force with which to be reckoned. Following Germany's defeat in World War II, Hoover toured Germany, again at the request of President Truman, to assess post-war food and reconstruction needs. Hoover found a dire situation. Massive destruction marked the long years of war. But the resilience of the German people surprised Hoover when, heeding a request from Chancellor Konrad Adenauer and President Eisenhower, he made a final visit to Europe in 1954. 80 years old at the time, Hoover made three speeches in this tour of Germany: to the Press Club of Bonn, Tübingen University, and before the Senate of the City of Berlin, claiming that the Germans had done outstanding work in transforming the devastated landscape of war into modern civilization. Hoover also noted, "This city of Berlin is on the front line of the Cold War. You are the combat soldiers in that war. Should it, which God forbid, ever become a hot war, you would be the first to face the enemy." The former president ended the speech on a note of optimism. "Thanks to the spirit and courage of men under the leadership of two great mayors, you can, like the men of ancient Athens, hold your head high and say, I am a Berliner." Sound familiar? About 8 months ago, a section of the 450-meter-long tunnel built in 1955 was uncovered by a man chopping wood in Pasewalk, just north of Berlin. Tunnels, by nature, are dark and mysterious places. We are indeed fortunate to have with us today one of the foremost authorities to shed some light on the Berlin Tunnel operation. The British Secret Intelligence Service often referred to it as Operation Stopwatch, while the American Central Intelligence Agency called it Operation Gold. However identified, it reflects ingenuity and provided vital intelligence to the West at a time of great uncertainty. No one wanted the Cold War to become World War III, and on several occasions, it appeared that another world war was likely. Fortunately, cooler heads prevailed, in large part based upon intelligence gathering and analysis provided by the CIA. Lou Mehrer is a retired CIA officer who served in senior assignments in Washington and abroad. He most recently participated in the United Kingdom film production, Spies Beneath Berlin, the history of the Berlin Tunnel operation. He holds a Bachelor of Arts degree, cum laude, in modern European history and German literature. He continued his studies at the University of Frankfurt in Germany as a Fulbright scholar, and later as a Woodrow Wilson Fellow at Rutgers University, where he earned a Master's of Arts in History. He is currently working under contract as a senior review officer in the CIA's declassification program. The title of today's program is The Berlin Operation, Tunnel Operation, a Cold War Intelligence Triumph. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Lou Mehrer.
Good afternoon. It is a pleasure, a genuine pleasure, to be here and participate in the Hoover Library's retrospective Along the Iron Curtain, Germany's Cold War Frontier. First, before going into my presentation, Joe Lambert, who is the CIA's Director of Information Management Services, is with us today. And I would like to thank Tom Schwartz personally. We have rarely been hosted so magnificently as we have the last 2 days and going in today and tomorrow. Thank you very much. If this keeps up, the Hoover Library will no longer be the best kept secret in the Midwest. You know, it's very interesting. Before coming into the auditorium, I had a chance to exchange some stories and reflections with people that had served in Berlin and in Germany during the Cold War. And then one fellow said, you know, you have a tough act to follow. I just saw Argo. And I said, well, I'm going to do the best I can to make this interesting. But you know, I think Ben Affleck has a tough act to follow. And what I submit is that he has a good candidate. My hope is that Mr. Affleck will see the C-SPAN video of this presentation and be motivated to follow up with a Hollywood version of the Berlin Tunnel operation. By way of introduction, I think it's good to recall that most people are aware of the Berlin airlift, they're aware of the Berlin Wall. But after the Berlin airlift in 1948, and before the building of the Berlin Wall in 1961, there was the Berlin Tunnel, another major event of the Cold War. The Berlin Wall has, I don't want to confuse the Berlin Tunnel with the Berlin Wall. The Berlin Tunnel has been variously described as a masterpiece of operational daring and technical ingenuity, and in fact it was. It was something that had never been tried before, and it required a joint operation that involved our British friends, British Intelligence Service, MI6, and also the contribution involvement of many in the intelligence community in the U.S., including and especially the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. The Berlin Tunnel operation was named PB jointly by the CIA and Stopwatch Gold by the British. It was a joint operation. And what did it involve? Not the escape of people, but the secret tapping of underground Soviet military communications cables. Okay? The operation lasted 11 months and 11 days, and it served, among other things, to alert and provide information to our policymakers on the possibility of Soviet intentions to attack the West. So we had a capability through the Berlin Tunnel operation to know about Soviet troop movements, Soviet intentions, and we were not going to be in the same position as we were when the Japanese attacked us at Pearl Harbor. You know, all operations have surprises. No matter how well you plan them, no matter what you set in place, no matter how brilliant the people. And this operation had its surprises. And one of them was that the KGB, the Soviet Intelligence Service, knew of this operation before Alan Dulles, our director, approved it. I will talk more about this fact that is so peculiar, but could only happen in intelligence. Okay. So, a little bit of background on the building of the Berlin and why the tunnel and why it was such an important undertaking. The Berlin Tunnel operation was born of desperation for intelligence sources. After the Second World War, we in the West, and particularly the United States, thought that having fought with the Soviet Union, together with the Soviet Union, having defeated Germany, that there would come a period of cooperation and that confrontation would be a thing of the past. But how wrong our policymakers were in that expectation. The Soviets had other designs, and in fact, whatever the threat was of Germany, it was replaced now by the threat of Soviet expansionism, not only in Europe, but in other areas of the world. The Soviets, in effect, established a hermetically sealed unit around the Soviet Union, and it sealed this country off from the rest of the world. So it resulted not only in the division of Europe, the division of Germany, Berlin, and also East and West. I mentioned the desperation for reporting sources. Apart from the occasional defector who came to us, we didn't have many agents in place. You know, unlike the Soviet government, that from the inception in 1917 went out and recruited agents all over the world. Oxford University, nuclear scientists in the United States, and on and so it goes. And so they were in a much better position to know what the Allies were doing, what we were doing. And as a matter of fact, it's likely that when we had the first atomic nuclear explosion, that Stalin was aware of it before Harry Truman. That's how good their intelligence sources were in the United States. So to our analysts, because we did not have good reporting sources, to our analysts, to borrow Churchill's phrase, Soviet Union was a riddle wrapped in a mystery inside an enigma. So therefore, there was this great pressure on the CIA to develop sources of intelligence and do something to make sure that the policy decisions we would reach, what we would do, would be based on factual information. And we can only get this through intelligence. The Soviets, until 1948, we did have the capability, having said all that, until 1948, we did have the capability to intercept Soviet communications. And we were able to read those secret correspondence. That source was betrayed to the Soviets in 1948, and the minute it was betrayed to the Soviets, that capability ceased. The day that that happened was 29 October 1948, that in intelligence history goes down as Black Friday. It's perhaps the most significant intelligence loss in the U.S. history up to that date. At about the same time, the Soviets began to bury their telephone lines, landlines. And that then made it even more difficult to get at the communications, to tap into them, to penetrate them. So that was a tremendous loss. The betrayal of what we were doing on the one hand, and the burial of these lines on the other, guaranteed that when the North Koreans went into the South, we didn't have advance warning because we were not able to tap into their communications. We lost that capability. So there was a desperation. A few comments on Berlin. You've heard already about, and we know so much about Berlin because Berlin continues to be fascinating. All the history that took place in Berlin, you know, beginning with the establishment of unified Germany, going up through the First World War, certainly the Second World War. I mean, Berlin was the center of attention and was the maker of history. Let's go back a little bit and talk about Berlin and how it relates to the Cold War and espionage. During the Cold War, Berlin was divided east and west and occupied. Berlin was often the flashpoint for crises and also a barometer of the relationships between east and west. Policymakers and analysts could look to Berlin and gauge what the state of relationships and relations were based on how things were going in Berlin. So Berlin did have our focus, did have our attention, as well as the attention of our adversaries. It's not a surprise, therefore, that John Le Carré, the famous spy novelist, dubbed Berlin as the eternal city of spies. Berlin became the spy capital of the world because of its strategic location. It's 100 miles inside communist territory, and Berlin, before the building of the wall, offered the ability for people in the east to go west and people in the west to go east. And by people, I include intelligence agents. Okay. Now, the origins of the wall, of the Berlin Tunnel, it's not, we don't know exactly the exact moment when this idea for the tunnel emerged. Some people, some biographers, credit General Reinhard Gehlen, the head of the West German Intelligence Service, as first alerting Alan Dulles to the possibility of building a tunnel, tapping into Soviet telephone cables. Others credit our chief of operations in Berlin, William Harvey King. More likely, however, the idea and its concept came from the British. The British service, MI6, in Vienna, had built a tunnel, much smaller than what we attempted and did in Berlin, that in fact successfully tapped into Soviet cables. And so, as the pressure increased for intelligence sources, and the focus was on Berlin, the access was on Berlin, the idea then came forward to build a tunnel, try to build this tunnel that would go from West Berlin into East Berlin. What this required was good relationships and discussions with the British, and to learn what they had learned and apply it to face us. And that worked out very well. At first glance, the idea seemed like something out of a novel, a thriller. To dig a tunnel a quarter of a mile in length, at roughly the length of the Lincoln Memorial reflecting pool, under enemy tunnel, under enemy territory, under a major highway, tap into secret communications, and do all of this without being detected. This had never been done or even tried before. The length of the tunnel would be 1,476 feet. Okay, the planning for this got underway, and in the spring of 1953, the decision was made to go ahead with the tunnel. The approval hadn't yet been given, but there were serious discussions. And so after consultations, director, Alan Dulles, signed the approval in January of 1954. And at that time, the decision was made that the U.S. team would be headed by Bill Harvey, chief of Berlin Operations Base, who in December 1953 was given overall responsibility for the tunnel. They couldn't have selected a better intelligence officer. I'll say a few details about this individual, remarkable individual. You know, Bill Harvey, and there are pictures on the internet that you can see, was a character that seemed to have come out of Central Casting. He was a bull of a man, balding, eyes bulging slightly, and perhaps because of a thyroid condition. Big, he always carried a six-shooter, shoulder holster. And when he would have particular difficult decisions to make with difficult people, they would come into his office and the six-shooter would be on the desk. This had impact. And then he also had a bottle of scotch, a bottle of grog. And he said, the bottle of scotch is there just in case. He was an extremely intelligent person. Born in Ohio, but grew up in Indiana. He graduated from high school at the age of 15. And after completing a law degree, joined the FBI. He had a falling out with J. Edgar Hoover. You know, the FBI agents at that time in the 40s, they had a two-hour call-in requirement, and that is that no FBI agent would be away from a call, to be pulled into duty more than 2 hours. So when the call come in, you should respond within 2 hours. Well, it was a particularly pleasant evening for Bill Harvey, and he had been to a party. He missed the call. And then he was told, well, you know what the rule is. You're going to be reassigned. And of course, the reassignment was something that to a place he didn't want to go. He then left the FBI, but he knew from reading in the papers that this new organization had been born. In July of 1947, the CIA Act was signed by Harry Truman, and here was the intelligence service, and he thought, well, maybe my services might be better applied with this new intelligence agency. And he joined the agency and became one of the leading operational officers we had. He was a perfect choice to head this operation. In Berlin, he headed up the CIA's largest and most active operational organization in Europe, and simultaneously became the driving force, often the brains and imagination behind the tunnel. Heading the British team was Peter Lunt, the station chief in Berlin. And there was he had a team of officers, and one of the officers there was named George Blake. George Blake attended all the meetings, planning sessions, was part of all the discussions. At the same time, he was already working for the Soviet KGB, reporting very conscientiously on what was being discussed, what was being planned, what would be done. So, I'm going to talk a little bit more about this interesting facet of this operation. Later. So, before the construction of the tunnel began, we had to do what? We had to recruit agents in East Berlin. Agents in the postal and communication system. Because to tap these high-level communications cables, we had to have somebody to help cover for us in the East and at the same time protect us when we went forward in the operation. We did that. We recruited a network of agents. Of course, it was also vital to know just exactly where to place the tap. And this is where the British contribution came in. Not only did these have us use a model they used in Vienna, but they had the expertise. And so the division of labor was as follows. The CIA would procure the site for the tunnel, design and dig the tunnel to the point where the Soviet cables would be tapped, provide security for the operations. And in addition, the agency would provide all the on-site recording and transcription equipment. In the end, we had over 600 reel-to-reel tape recorders going 24/7. Okay? What did the British do? The British had the expertise on how to penetrate, how to tap into communications cables. And that was no small expertise or feat. The cables that they had to penetrate without signaling a compromise to the East Germans was insulated with nitrogen gas under pressure. This nitrogen gas had two purposes. If it were penetrated, it would give a signal, or if a weather condition had damaged the cables, that would also be known to, at the central control board of the communications center. So this becomes even more important later on. But what the British were able to do is, after the tunnel was built, and I'll talk more about the tunnel, but I think it's important to make this point about the British contribution and their expertise. They built a tap chamber, went up, and penetrated the nitrogen gas insulation with a perfect tap. Three cables. Each cable had 172 different circuits. Can you imagine the information that this provided? Okay. Now, the site selection. Bill Harvey, again, was in the lead. He said, "But we would like to put this site, the tunnel, in the southeastern part of the American zone of occupation in Berlin, in a specific area called Rudow, R-U-D-O-W, in this district of Altglienicke." So they looked at that, it seemed good, went forward with the planning. Lieutenant Leslie M. Gross of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers was picked to direct and oversee the on-site construction. It was a daunting task because the question was, what do you do with over 3,100 tons of soil? What do you deal with this? Because the minute this would, any part of this would be noticed on the other side, it would compromise, it would give away the whole operation. So the idea that they came up with, we will build a two-story warehouse about the size of a square block. The basement would be dug out in such a way to bring the soil, all the dirt from the tunnel, and store it in this building, in this warehouse. Because this tunnel had to be built under the Schönfelder Chaussee, or highway that linked, the highway ended at the Schönfelder Airport in East Berlin, it would have to withstand a dead weight of over 10 feet, and in addition, support all the vehicular traffic, which sometimes included a 60-ton battle tank. Okay? So, the design was very important, materials to be used was very important, and in choosing the design was also very imaginative. They came up with, the British thought we ought to go in and use cement blocks to build this tunnel. And American engineers said, well, you know, given what we have here, the tunnel, we know about the soil conditions, let's go in with the steel, construct steel plates with a corrugated body, flanged, and install these one at a time as we dig into the tunnel. And in fact, when the tunnel was built, it would move forward 18 inches at a time. They would lock the plates together. Also what they did, to add to the strength, because of the way the tunnel was built, there would always be a space between the steel plates and the roof of the tunnel on the sides. So they went in with a grout system, and then before it was all over, they used over 1,000 pounds of grout to seal the sound and also keep the soil on top from caving in. The warehouse itself was built not to attract attention to what else was going on. They mounted antennas on the roof of this warehouse, circling radar, and the attempt that they tried to convey was that this was, in fact, a facility that was either monitoring the airport in East Berlin, or in fact, was a facility that was collecting electronic intelligence, or signal intelligence, E-link or signaling. And that makes it very interesting because here you have a cover to protect a cover. So anyway, it was Bill Harvey's concept, and it was then implemented. actual work on the tunnel began on 2 September 1954. And they dug a vertical shaft inside the warehouse, 18 feet in diameter, and went 20 feet into the ground. Getting back to the plates, to give you a good idea of how many we used, 125 tons of these steel plates were used for this tunnel. Now, here's where some of the genius of Bill Harvey comes to play. And being an integral part of the planning, the implementation of this operation, he brought some imagination. He said, you know, when the tunnel gets built, I want a door, a steel door with levers built close to the tap chamber. Tap chamber is where we penetrate the silver cables. He says, on that door, I would like in Russian, English, and German to have this inscription. Entrance is forbidden by the commandant of Berlin. And some of the younger officers, now, Bill, you think that's going to stop anybody? And Bill Harvey said, no. He says, but remember, these Germans, these Russians, almost from the moment of birth, are trained to obey orders. When the day comes and the Russian soldiers, the East German soldiers come through this tunnel, they will see this on this door. It's an armor-plated door, and they will pause. And I need all the time I can get that once this happens, we want to get out of there and have as much time as possible. Okay, made sense. But that was not enough. He said, you know, he said, farther in the tunnel, on a pile of sandbags, I want a 50 caliber machine gun mounted. And this gave some people a heart attack. They said, Bill, you're not going to kill them, are you? And he says, no. He says, but I'll tell you something. There's nothing that will send a shiver down your back like the sound of a 50 caliber machine gun being cocked to shoot. So as they're coming into the tunnel, that sound reverberating will give them pause for thought. In fact, he was right. The other thing that Bill Harvey insisted on was at the point, the exact point where we had penetrated those cables, communications cables, there was a microphone placed. That microphone was, again, active 24/7. What Bill Harvey wanted to do is to know the when the tap chamber was entered, what the reactions of the intruders would be, and to have it all reported. And so that was also very interesting. Okay, as I said, the technical facets of these operations. As I said, heretofore, no one had tunneled 1,476 feet under climb distance conditions, and to hit a target approximately two square inches and 27 inches below the surface of the ground. And this is the point where the arc taps were made, an area like this, approximately 27 inches below the surface of the ground. Incredible aiming was required. So what happened? They said, well, to triangulate the exact location, somebody came up with the idea, why don't we have a baseball game? We have our people out there playing baseball, and accidentally that ball will go over into the East German side, where we want it to go. And the right spot, we can triangulate and identify the exact spot for this tap chamber and the tap. Well, what they didn't anticipate was they had their baseball game. Only problem is, the friendly East German guards, every time the baseball... it was from back. So, after a few attempts, we decided to regroup. And it so happened about the same time, there was a new device developed. It was called the Electronic Distance Measuring System. A device about that big, and an electronic device. And so what they decided is to drive a Jeep over into the eastern part, into East Berlin, and develop an engine problem near the site that they needed to triangulate. And back then, our military had a right to go into the east as the Soviets had a right to come into the west. That was part of the agreement, Allied agreement, with the Soviets. And so, yes, they got over there with their car. Oh, the engine had a problem, lift up the hood. put the electronic distance measuring device on the fender. Okay, we got it. Put it all down. The motor was taken care of. It was no longer faulty. And it came back with the right measurements. So, as I said, the three cables that were tapped, two in May of 1955, and then the last one, the third, in August, and again, 170 circuits on each cable. As soon as the tap was completed, it was incredible the kind of information, the volume of information that was coming out from these penetrations. Spot reports were going to Washington, to London. It was just amazing, the sheer volume of intelligence that this was producing. To give you an idea of what it took to process this, we needed linguists and analysts. In London, we had over 317 Russian linguists who were employed to do the transcriptions of the Russian language recordings. In Washington, we had 350 linguists that transcribed the Russian teletypes. Over the life of this operation, we used almost 600 reel-to-reel tape recorders. We used over 50,000 reels of magnetic tapes. They weighed altogether 25 tons. In total, 40,000 telephone conversations were recorded and processed and utilized, and 6 million teletype messages were heard and transcribed. Now, we get back to this fascinating point that is so unbelievable, it stretches credulity, and you'll say, well, you know, didn't you just say that the KGB was aware of this? How is this all possible? Did they not use this channel of communication that we had established to feed in disinformation? As you know, the KGB had a separate directorate called for Disinformatia, whose sole purpose was to produce disinformation disseminated worldwide to further the Soviet cause and to hurt ours. So that was a legitimate question. How is it possible that we could be so pleased with ourselves on this operation and not know for sure that this was not disinformation? Again, I said, all operations have surprises, and this one certainly had its share. I'll get to that point. Okay. Now, so the tunnel was in place. We're getting all this information. George C. Marshall, one of the highest ranking military officers in our military and also Secretary of State, once said, you know, that he didn't care what this tunnel cost, what it would take. He wanted it because he said, I absolutely need 24 hours of warning in the event of the Soviet attack. Keeping in mind, all these people were part of that generation that experienced Pearl Harbor. And they did not want to have a repeat, this time from a much more dangerous adversary. And so for him, the tunnel served its purpose. It provided the capability for early warning. That was his main job as far as our policymakers were concerned. Now, like in life, so in intelligence, all good things come to an end. And how did this happen with the tunnel? The KGB never revealed the existence of the tunnel to anyone outside the KGB. What did the tunnel in were the heavy rains in Berlin in the spring of 1956. So heavy were the rains that in one of the cables, moisture had intruded. And in this case, the telephone workmen had to go out and investigate. And in investigating where the problem cable was, they discovered the tap chamber. Okay. So, through the microphone that Bill Harvey had installed, he heard the Russian soldiers and East German workmen come through. And it was interesting that when they first saw the microphone, but there was a device there, and one of the Germans said, "What is that thing?" And his partner said, "Don't worry about it, it's part of the cable system." But it was still there, and eventually they did identify, in fact, what it was. But in the meantime, one of the intruders who came down initially was heard to explain on the tape, "Donovetta, look at that," pointing to, at the top of the cable. It goes all the way under the highway to the west. How did the Americans do it? It's fantastic. Another said, "What a filthy trick, and where you would least expect it." A Russian-speaking German, remember we had good linguists, said with some admiration how neatly and tidily they have done it. So, at 3:35 Sunday afternoon on 22 April 1956, the tap cables were cut by our adversaries, and the tunnel ceased to operate. It lasted 11 months and 11 days. Now, on the following day, I should say this too. You know, when you have an operation, as I said, it's like life. You have a beginning, and you know you always have an end. And you always wonder, when this operation's end, you think of how it might end. And you work that into the formula of the operational planning. In this case, two things happened. We miscalculated as to what would happen at the end of the operation, and so did the Soviets. The Soviets, when they realized what had happened, this Marshal Andrei Grechko, commander of a group of Soviet forces in Germany, decided that, well, first of all, he was incensed. Enraged is a better word, because he described this tunnel as a blatant act of imperialist aggression and international gangsterism. Okay. Now, so what did the Soviets decide to do? They were going to be very clever about this. And that is, they decided to bring in Western journalists, as well as those from Soviet bloc, show them the tunnel, show them how nefarious we had been in building this tunnel, and that the world would then applaud the Soviets and deride and criticize what we had done. Soviets totally miscalculated. Rather than, admit that an operation of this magnitude could be running for almost a year and go undetected, the Soviets, for their part, decided to focus on public relations. So, what did they do? Called the press in. And what happened was that, much to Grechko's surprise and disgust, the Western press uniformly hailed the tunnel as a striking example of American capacity for daring undertakings. Okay? Here's some other press clippings from the same time. New York Herald Tribune, 27 May 1956. "A venture of extraordinary audacity. The stuff of which thrillers are made. The chamber near the Soviet sector, end of the tunnel, looked like the communication center of a battleship." The Washington Post called it the tunnel of love. And they said, I quote, "We cannot help thinking that the communists have made a grievous mistake to raise so much fuss about this discovery. Very few Germans even suspected that the Americans were capable of so much cleverness." Time magazine called it the wonderful tunnel. They said, it's the best publicity the U.S. has had in Berlin for a long time, and that's true. It was much needed. Boston Post, which was not always friendly or positively disposed towards us, grudgingly wrote an article with the title, "Hope It Is True." And this is what they said. "Frankly, we didn't know that American intelligence agents were that smart. But now we take it all back." So anyway, it was very gratifying. This success in Germany came at a very good time. I think there were seminal moments in our relationship with post-war Germany. I think the airlift was certainly one. If there was any vestige of animosity towards Americans, that evaporated after the Berlin airlift. And here we are into the mid part of the decade in the 50s, 1955, 56. And there were moments in that history where people began to doubt our resolve, our capabilities. Do we still have the right stuff? Well, this tunnel, when it was revealed, showed the world we still did. A final comment on the business of intelligence and intelligence as a career. I mean, one of the things that we as intelligence officers accept, and that is that, you know, our successes will always be protected and hidden, and our failures will be trumpeted. The one thing about the way the Soviets handled this tunnel revelation, for the first time, and perhaps I don't think we've ever had this happen again, we had such positive press reaction. I remember when the announcement was made that bin Laden had been killed. And I thought, well, you know, this is a main terrorist, one of our main enemies is no longer here to threaten us. But even that, there was in the West press comments and press stories that even questioned, you know, should we have done this? Why didn't we put him on trial, et cetera, et cetera. The Berlin Tunnel in the press got unequivocal praise. And as I say, I think it's the only time that this has happened with regard to an intelligence operation. The value, I've talked a lot about the value of this operation, the cost. Cost in dollars was around $6 million. In terms of dollars today, it would be $50, maybe $75 million. This was significant. And even today, $50 to $75 million is significant. But it was worth it. As I said, the Berlin Tunnel, first and foremost, provided strategic warning should it have been needed on the intentions and capabilities of the Soviet Union. It also provided good information and insights into the relationships between key military and political figures in the Soviet hierarchy and on relationships between the Soviets and their Eastern European allies. We also developed very good intelligence on the improved nuclear capabilities of the Soviet Air Force in East Germany. We identified hundreds of personalities and locations associated with the Soviet nuclear program. Then, last but not least, from an intelligence standpoint, we identified 300 KGB officers. We also identified more than 350 GRU officers. GRU officers were the Soviet military officers. The GRU also contained the counterpart to our NSA. Keep in mind, I'm going to talk about this a little bit more. The KGB never told the GRU that we were listening to all the communications. And so in sum, the operation was a treasure trove of intelligence and counterintelligence on targets of the highest priority of the U.S., the British, and our allies. Okay, we've now come to the point where I'm going to talk about what is almost unbelievable and could only happen in real intelligence and would never be accepted as credible in a spy novel. George Blake. Remember George Blake? George Blake was the Soviet mole who kept the KGB informed on the tunnel and its progress. During the Second World War, he was a British naval officer and acted in Europe as a courier for the Dutch underground. He joined the British intelligence service, MI6, in 1948, and was in Korea at the time the North Koreans launched the attack into the south. He was one of several British nationals who were captured. Over the next 3 years, he was held prisoner. He was then released, came back to England, and it is now the conclusion that he had been recruited as a spy during his imprisonment in the Korean War. You know, so to me, it's amazing that someone who lived during the Stalinist periods, the purges after the Second World War, living in the West, could in any way believe that our adversaries in the East had anything superior to what we had. We were perfect, but thank God we were not like they were. But nevertheless, he did become a convinced communist, a dedicated communist. And one of the interesting things he said was, in later years, he said what in part gave him the interest in communism was that he was given a manual to read for British intelligence officers on communism. So here was a publication possibly trying to point out all the things that were bad about communism and why we were resisting and fighting that system, but he took an opposite view. We began to see some positive things in this, and he said this led to his rethinking about his position and his loyalties. So, why did the KGB become complicit in the Berlin Tunnel operation in so many respects? Because George Blake was a perfect penetration of an intelligence service. I believe the British saw in George Blake a person who could possibly advance to become head of the British service. What the KGB was going to do then was going to do everything that was necessary to protect his status, his activities, and promote his career within that service so that he could rise to the top and eventually become head of the service. You know, if you recruit the head of, let's say, of MI6, you've recruited a lot of the American service as well. This is what the Soviets intend to do. To maximize this intelligence potential of this agent. And so therefore, they decided to do what is almost unimaginable. They were going to let the CIA and MI6 listen in, record, and report all of their conversations emanating in and around East Berlin, conversations and communications with Moscow over that time, so as not to endanger the fact that they had an agent in place. So when the tunnel was revealed, and the Soviets made a big issue of it with the press and everybody, what is interesting is this, is even as they have all these Soviet officers, East Germans, come through, there's not one KGB officer that arrives at the scene. The Soviet complaints and all of the grievances that they issued focused on the U.S. In their communications and their complaints, there is no reference made at all to the British. So this was part of the scenario that they put in place. Protect George Blake above all. Well, after the tunnel was revealed, George Blake was rather worried, because both the British and the U.S. went back to do a post-mortem study. How did this happen? Was the revelation of the tunnel in any way a result of an operational weakness, an oversight, or was it betrayed by a traitor in the operation? The conclusion was no, that this tunnel was revealed simply because Mother Nature allowed more rain to fall in Berlin than some of these cables could withstand, this prompting the East Germans and the Soviets to come in. And so it was not a human failure. This is all a natural cause. And of course, George Blake was relieved because, as I said, he was very nervous during that period. And then this gave him 5 more years to report on his service's activities to the KGB and on ours. Now, how did his story come to an end? We had a good source who came to us from a satellite country and said, you know, I have a name of a person here that you should be very interested in. This is George Blake, and he's working for the Soviets. So this information was passed to the British Intelligence Service. George Blake was arrested, tried, and convicted, sentenced to 42 years in prison. Again, I say, this story has many surprises. After serving only 5 years, he was able to recruit people in the prison who joined with the KGB officers outside the prison, and they sprung him loose. Very mysterious how all this was done, but they got him out. This is in a British prison. Put him in a car, drove him to London, and the next stop was Moscow, where he lives today. He was resettled in Moscow, and Oleg Kalugin, who's now in the United States, former colonel of the KGB, you've seen him in the news, was his resettlement officer. So, anyway, he did write a book in 1990 called No Other Choice, where he tried to explain his motives, tried to justify what he did, and as far as I know, it was not a bestseller, except in Soviet Union. But you know, the man has longevity. He just celebrated, George Blake just celebrated his 90th birthday. And one of the congratulatory notes that he received was from President Vladimir Putin, who praised him for services to the Soviet Union, Russia. And I guess Mr. Putin is looking forward to some kind of documentary they're going to do on George Blake. Perhaps an answer to the ones that the British did. So, in any case, he's still alive, celebrates his 90th birthday, and so this probably will not be the last that we've heard of him. You know, another thing I should point out, Bill Harvey. On the day that the tunnel was revealed, someone placed a black wreath on his office door to mark that very black day when this whole operation had to come to an end. And it was like somebody dying. It was so much part of this operation, so intensely involved, that it was like a death in the family. So, you know, before going on to questions, because it's the theme of this wonderful event that we have, the exhibition, the retrospective on the Cold War, Germany, and the front lines, I put some thoughts together on the Cold War that I think should be articulated. And that is, as we Americans look back on the Cold War, there's one thing that really stands out, and that is the Cold War brought out the best in us. And the Cold War brought out the worst in our adversaries. You know, we did not build walls. We did not set up barbed wire to keep people out. We opened our gates to people that were persecuted for religious or political reasons. We welcomed them. After the Second World War, so many Germans immigrated to the United States. And by the way, hundreds and thousands were former POWs who had been camped in the United States. When the Russians tried to starve West Berlin, we mounted the Berlin airlift to keep West Berliners alive and safe. So with every brutality from the system, and by the way, I agree with Ronald Reagan, this was an evil empire. With every brutality that this system can come up with, we answered with generosity. When the Soviets suppressed the Hungarian Revolution, and they did it in a very bloody way, we welcomed, in the United States, over 50,000 Hungarian refugees. There are many other stories, and we who are lucky enough to have lived through then and are still alive can recollect those moments. And as I said, I think this is one thing that is so much part of America, is the generosity spirit of this country. I think I'll stop there. And if you have any questions, I'll be glad to entertain them.
Either side, so if you have a question, raise your hand. A microphone will be passed. Make sure the green light is on, and please remember to speak into the microphone.
Could you tell us a little bit about how you knew or how you evaluate whether what you were hearing was the truth or what they wanted us to hear?
That's an excellent question. Excellent question. Because one of the things that we have to do in the intelligence business is when we get intelligence reports or information, the thought always has to be, can we verify what we have? How can we establish that what we're getting is the truth, is factually correct? And one of the ways that this is done is at looking at multiple sources of intelligence reporting, including open source. And say, if this person says, this tank column moved on this date at this time to this place, you say, okay, but let's see if we can confirm that through other reporting. And so what you have is that verification process that goes forward. You have good analysts, you know, with good knowledge, who have the expertise, the background. But the analysis continues, especially with the Berlin Tunnel. The people involved always knew that one of the things, I mean, that we have all this coming, all this information coming, and even before we knew, it was George Blake sharing this with the KGB. The question always was, why are the Soviets allowing this to happen? You know, there's incredible volume of conversations on the most sensitive matters. And so it became very important through other sources to see if we have something that can confirm, support what was being reported, and then say so. I mean, one of the things that happens in the intelligence reporting process, especially where you have important issues being reported, discussed, if you have only one source, then what you do, you admit it. You say, this is one source, we haven't confirmed this yet, but we'll try to do so as soon as possible. Just to let the policymakers know and senior analysts that this is one source for the moment. And also we would, of course, add how reliable the source is, what the reporting record has been, and over time you do establish a record for reporting, and it also leads to either a sense of confidence or lack thereof. Yes?
I have two questions. Yep. The first one is, all those reels of tape, do they have to bring them back to the United States? And then the second question is, what followed up, what did we do for intelligence after this?
Well, I am not sure where the tapes are, okay, at this point. I do know that after the tunnel ceased in operation, we spent 3 years catching up and going through all the material we'd gotten. So information from the tunnel was being disseminated 3 years after the tunnel was closed down. And your other question was, what happened after the tunnel? Okay. Well, you know, technology continues to evolve. And we had the U-2 spy plane developed, that brought us new capabilities, other technical innovations that helped, and also keeping in mind that, okay, the tunnel ceased to exist April 23, 1956. The last week of October and November was the Hungarian Revolution, 1956. And that also opened up new possibilities for reporting. And as I said, you know, we are always eager to take advantage when these opportunities arise. And throughout the history, and there were other people, but we had, without getting into specific agents, we did have a number of very good recruitments. And unfortunately, most of them paid with their lives. But over the years, we were always lucky. I mean, one of the things that always impressed me was that I could never understand anybody from the West becoming a spy. One of the reasons is that inevitably, at some point in time, the counterpart in the KGB would one day wake up and say, you know, this system isn't quite what it says it is. I mean, these were people who had to live a lie. There were ideologues, some were true believers, but they began to see the lies in the system. The other thing was, they knew that Americans, we, would be very welcoming and generous if they came to us. And so we did have then a number of very good defectors, other sources of information developed, and technological improvements made that over time then it not only matched what the tunnel gave us, but in some cases exceeded it. And don't forget also that U-2 flights were replaced by more sophisticated aircraft, and then finally the spy satellites. Yes?
On Black Friday, 1948, mm-hmm. how did the Soviets find out that we were intercepting their transmissions?
We had a person in the U.S. government betray this to the Soviet Union, to the Russians. Yes?
Did they put the equipment in a museum in East Berlin, and did they fill that tunnel with cement?
Okay, there is the Allied Museum in Berlin, and I... There is the Allied Museum in Berlin, okay, that has is dedicated to the events of the Cold War. And if you are in Germany and you happen to be in Berlin, I suggest you visit this museum. One of the items at the Allied Museum in Berlin is a section of the Berlin Tunnel. You know? And it is a real section. It's not something that has been built like it. It is an authentic piece of that tunnel. It has the sandbags that were used for the walls. It shows you the wooden tracks that were used. And so the picture, by the way, out here, in front of the hall here, is a picture of that section from the Allied Museum. There are all kinds of other things that are there. The pictures of, for example, and this is marvelous, the wall and the exhibit that Tom here has put together on Berlin, on the wall. One of the photos that I think is so amazing is as the Germans, East Germans, built the wall, they strung out this barbed wire. And you see the East German soldier standing there. And then one newspaper reporter, photographer, caught the instant when an East German sergeant, Konrad Schumann, with his Kalashnikov rifle, sorry, jumps over this high strand of barbed wire, successfully, and his foot hits the barbed wire, and he comes all the way over in full uniform, armed, and what a picture that made. And that leads me also to make this observation. It's really interesting, you know, pictures are so powerful. And the communists, you know, never lost an opportunity to give us a picture that depicted how awful they were. In other words, we who do publicity in our country would never have to lie. We would never have to make up a picture. Our adversaries provided all the truth we needed. And you know, pictures worth a thousand words. Now, there's a sad side to Konrad Schumann. He resettled in the West, in Bavaria, led a fairly good life, and then when the wall came down and Germany united, he developed his relatives who remained in East Germany. Somehow that relationship didn't work out for whatever reason, and he went into a deep depression, and he hanged himself. His wife found him one morning on one of the fruit trees, and that was it. So, for a lot of these people, the Cold War was intense, and the lives that the Cold War exacted just didn't end when the wall went down.
The back row's turn here.
Pardon me?
The back row's turn here. Sorry.
Okay. Yes?
I have a couple of questions. Number one, were the Germans, West Germans, apprised of this operation on any level at all? I think those were the days of Konrad Adenauer. Do you know if he was involved in number two? Is what happened to our recruits in East Berlin? Do you know their fate?
The my knowledge of this operation was that it was exclusively U.S. and British. The security of operation often depends on is in direct proportion to the fewer people who know the better. There was no need to bring the West Germans into this operation. There was no value added. You only bring the people into the operation, you only make people knowledgeable of the operation who materially can contribute to it. Also keep in mind, this was a time when West Berlin was under special status, forces agreement, and the Berlin Germans in the West did have ties to West Berlin, political and otherwise, but we, in our sectors, and the Russians in theirs, had great latitude in what we did and how we did it. Now, you asked about the people that helped us. One of the things that I'm proud to say is that we meet our commitments, that those people who help us, we don't leave behind.
Over here. Yeah. Question? Looking back at it in retrospect now, 60 years later, 70 years later, what I'm wondering is how, I mean, if there's any knowledge of this, it probably is somewhere, somebody has knowledge of this, but how close did the Soviets come during in the late 40s, early 50s, the Cold War, how close did they come to actually invading Western Europe? I was over there in the service in 1957-58, and my perception was at the time, you know, we were relaxed. You know, we didn't have any sense of impending doom, like they were going to invade us tomorrow. Maybe they were going to, but the perception wasn't there.
You know, the Soviets were great opportunists, and they always looked for weaknesses. I mean, one of the reasons the North Koreans, I understand, that when they invaded South Korea, was that they didn't quite understand what our commitment was against communist expansionism. We had very good leaders, and President Truman and his doctrine articulated, and everybody knows the containment policy. What we established for the Soviets was, okay, this is where we draw the line. And while we are not going to threaten you, as long as you stay behind that line, neither will we let you go over it. And so what the Soviets did, they continued to probe for weakness, to see where they could advance their interests and their ideology. And at the right moments, we said, no, enough is enough. The one instance, to answer your question, where things were, and I'm not going to get into the Cuban Missile Crisis, that's separate. But sticking to Europe, the origins of the wall. I know that the Berlin Wall is not this topic for today, but you know, the East German government had tried for years to get the Soviets to approve their building a wall that would seal off East Berlin from West Berlin. I mean, Ulbricht went to Stalin and said, you know, can I do something here to stop the flow of my people leaving East Berlin, East Germany, and going to the West? And by the way, as Tom pointed out the other night, from the late 40s until the wall was built, 2.7 million people left the East to come to the West. Now, each Soviet leader, I mean, Stalin did not approve the building wall. Khrushchev tried to put a brake on any thoughts about building a wall. And then we had the Vienna summit occur, where Khrushchev and President Kennedy got together. Khrushchev, his conclusion from this summit was that perhaps he could do things in a more aggressive way than he had thought. And you know, we had a young president, this was his first summit meeting. President Kennedy just had this awful disaster called the Bay of Pigs, among other things. So in June of 1960, he met with Khrushchev. Well, Khrushchev didn't get the message that Kennedy wanted. What Kennedy really wanted was this. He was afraid, as he once said. He said, you know, all wars start from stupidity. And one thing I don't want to happen is that we have another war where millions of people are killed, and it's all because of some stupid decision that is made. And so he wanted to talk to Khrushchev, engage him, and say, can we come to an agreement here about what we do, what we won't do, and lessen the tensions, bring down the confrontation that we face? Well, just the opposite happened. After Khrushchev had the meeting in Vienna, he went to Ulbricht and said, you know, go ahead and build a wall. Kennedy, on his part, called the experience in that summit the worst day of his life. And so, yes, the wall went up. Kennedy's reaction was, well, wait a minute, the wall's on their side, it's not on ours. And but where we came close, where things would have gone from Cold War to Hot War, was on 27 October 1961, when the Soviet and American tanks faced off at Checkpoint Charlie. If somebody had pulled the trigger at that moment, we might have had the beginning of the Third World War. But it didn't happen, thank God. But the communists and the Soviets always pushed for opportunities.
Just one quick question. You've made references to the KGB as being the espionage concern or threat from Soviet Union. having had the opportunity to be stationed in Europe and working on the U.S. Nuclear weapons contingency plans, our major concern, or the villain, if you will, that our attention was always focused on, was a Soviet military liaison mission, disaffectionately known as SMILM. Does that dovetail into the KGB in any way?
I tell you, I'm not. I have no knowledge on that subject. Yes.
There was an agreement between the Allies that allowed for these missions, which usually consisted of one vehicle, a sedan or something like that, and three or four officers and men. And they could go into each other's territory, and they overtly spied on each other, and they were only stopped when the spying became, or the penetration became outrageous. And one of the really strange things about it is, in one book that I read about it, written by an American officer who was in the liaison mission, he got captured one night by the East German Army. And he says, "I won't talk to you people. You call your commanding officer so-and-so, who's a Russian officer." Mm-hmm. And this turned out to be his commanding officer. So that they had a commanding officer to protect their rights. And the Russians that were coming into our area had to have an American commanding officer to protect their rights.
Right.
Very interesting. Up on the border, we used to chase these people around, but you couldn't keep up with a sedan in a Jeep.
Yeah. We, our military, could go to the east, and they could come to this as part
of
the agreement.
They could come to us.
They could drive around, make their surveys, right, and go back and do their reports.
Right.
Yeah. That was, you know, if I remember correctly, I think right before the wall came down, it's one of those tragic events. I think part of an American who had gone, you know, this is a legitimate, open, overt drive-through into East Berlin on a scheduled tour, that somehow there was a communications snafu or whatever happened, and he was shot at and killed. And so there's always this misunderstanding, you know, people with weapons, not understanding, not communicating, disaster does happen. Anybody else? How are we doing time-wise?
I was wondering if you had an opinion on the relative balance of capability in the world today as far as intelligence gathering capabilities of the various nations.
Oh, well, I would say we have the finest. I mean, look at our war against terrorism. I think we're doing okay. And I really have to salute all the people who are out there that are fighting this battle against terrorism. And I made a comment to some people earlier, and that is, in a Cold War, we had a tremendous advantage. We had a relatively rational adversary. These people had their communist ideology. And you know, it was very interesting. They didn't believe in an afterlife. So they were not eager to die. They realized, according to their own beliefs, this is it. And, you know, they thought twice before sacrificing it all over a political misunderstanding. The incredible challenge facing the people who are battling this new evil, terrorism, is they are fighting people who want to die. And how you deal with this successfully and come up on top is very difficult. All I can say is I applaud what we are doing. I think that what we have done is really admirable. And I salute all the people who 24/7 are out there ensuring that we remain safe.
You might have already just briefly touched on this, but you mentioned it specifically that back in this generation that this intelligence gathering was widely applauded. Mm-hmm. But now, here, when just recently with Osama bin Laden and the war on terrorism, we're almost doing kind of the same thing, but yet it's very much controversial. So why do you believe is that the case, and is there a way that such a widely applauded intelligence gathering, like the one we are learning about today, could be widely accepted here in this time now.
Well, of course, you know, the times are different. I think the political landscape has changed. And, you know, I grew up at a time when politics stopped at the ocean's shore. And so a lot of this is wrapped around politics. A lot of it is wrapped around not being completely informed in some cases. So it is more difficult. I just wish we could come to more unanimity about certain vital questions and in our country and the dangers that we face. But you know, it is what it is. And the world is changing, we have changed, and what is today is not what was then. But I only am thankful that in fact we're doing as well as we are.
Do you think it's for the better or for the worse?
Well, for the better. I think the system is more complicated. I think it takes more effort. It takes more energy on the part of our policymakers to get things done. You know, there was a way that people were able to get together and say, you know, we have our differences, but let's agree on what is vital. But I'm not a political person. All I do is follow the news, and I wish it were better from day to day.